Welcome to Canvas Church. You are listening to our weekly celebration service message. Thank you for tuning in.
It's a good day to be in church. It is a good day, by the way, because, anytime you get free food, that's always good, right? Small groups launching, can't go wrong with that. Who's excited for small groups? And I got a free coffee from my daughter, so it's a great day. Yeah, don't be jealous. Have a daughter, and you can have free coffee too. Hey, if you like notes, taking notes, we have some paper notes, and the ushers are coming right now, and they can give you some paper notes. We also have them on our app, and you can get our app by texting the word app to 858-943-2221, and you can get all of our notes right there. But I'm excited today to close out our series in which we've been in, entitled Mixtape. People have asked me, what is mixtape all about? It's just a creative way for us to do a series without doing a series. And so that's what we've been doing all summer long. We've had a ton of guest speakers. Matter of fact, we got to do something right now. We got to dismiss all of the middle school because I see teachers back there waiting. They're looking at, they have the death stare going on right now. They're looking at me like, we prepared hard. So middle schoolers, we got a great class for you. You can go ahead and be dismissed and go to your class. It's going to be awesome. And teachers, don't kill me, all right? It's all good. We got it. So. But we've been in this series, and really it hasn't been a series. What it's been is God just released a lot of our pastors here with some great messages over the summer. We've had a few guest speakers come in, but I want to say this, that every single one of those messages, man, God has just been ministering to our church as a whole, but also to many of you as individuals, and it's just been an incredible series, non-series. And today, as we close it out, I felt like God spoke to me as I was praying for this weekend out of Mark 16:20. In which it declares that as the disciples went out and preached the gospel, that he came and confirmed the word that they were preaching with signs and wonders following. And as I was praying for the weekend, I just felt like God said, hey, Ben, I want to do some awesome things in people's lives this weekend. I want to do some miracles. I want to do some breakthroughs. I want to bring some hope and some healing. And so that's been my prayer leading up to this Sunday, that God would do that, that he would confirm all of these incredible messages that have been preached throughout the summer, that he would just confirm it, and he would show up. Whatever area of your life you need a breakthrough, God's going to do that today. Do you believe that? Matter of fact, I got a text message this morning. We have an incredible man on staff named Arturo, and last night we got a text from his daughter saying that his wife was being rushed to the hospital with some heart complications. Ended up being that she ended up having a minor heart attack and had to have surgery last night. And so they did some procedures and took care of her. And then she asked, would you be praying? Or the daughter asked, would you be praying for her? And of course, we said yes. And so we started praying. This morning we got a text, and the doctors are calling it a minor miracle. Come on, somebody. They literally, this morning I get that text, as I'm praying for a weekend of hope and healing and breakthrough in people's lives, we get this text that the doctors can't believe. They went and they did the procedure, but normally the response is not what they're seeing right now, and they're just dumbfounded. But we know, come on, God is a healer. He does miracles today just like he did in the Bible. And so we're actually going to go to John chapter 2 this morning as we close out our series, and we're going to look at the very first miracle that Jesus did. Now, how do we know it's the very first miracle Jesus did? Because the Bible says this is the first miracle Jesus did. About 37 miracles in the New Testament that Jesus did. We're going to talk about some of them today, but this is the very first one. And as we look at it, I believe there's some stuff in here for us today that we're going to observe that will really, I think, set us all up for a miracle in our life. And so let's go there. John chapter 2. I'm reading from the New Living Translation, and it reads this. It says, the next day, there was a wedding celebration in the village of Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the celebration. The wine supply ran out during the festivities, so Jesus' mother told him, they have no more wine. Dear woman, that's not our problem, Jesus replied. My time has not yet come. What is Jesus referencing there? Jesus is referencing, the book of John is such a phenomenal book because it speaks to the supremacy of Christ, his power, his work, all throughout it. And what Jesus is doing here, he's saying, hey, look, my time to display my power and my glory in that magnitude has not yet come. But yet watch and see what happens. Verse 5. But his mother told the servants, do whatever he, Jesus, tells you. Standing nearby were 6 stone water jars used for Jewish ceremonial washing. Each could hold about 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus told the servants, fill the jars with water. When the jars had been filled, he said, now dip some out and take it to the master of the ceremonies. So the servants followed his instructions. When the master of the ceremonies tasted the water that was now wine, not knowing where it had come from, though of course the servants knew, he called the bridegroom over. A host always serves the best wine first, he said. Then when everyone has had a lot to drink, he brings out the less expensive wine. But you have kept the best until now. This miraculous sign in Cana of Galilee was the first time Jesus revealed his glory and his disciples believed in him. I want to talk to you as we close out this series on the idea of a miracle in the making. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much for your word today. God, we thank you that your word is awesome. Lord, thank you for what you've already done today in the midst of worship as we celebrated around communion. But God, I pray you would continue the incredible work you have here today for Canvas Church. I pray, Lord, that you do the work that you have planned for those that are visiting for the first time, checking it out. God, those that are new to the faith. God, I pray you'd help me now in this environment to create a place for people to discover your son, Jesus, know your incredible love, and realize the amazing plan that you have for them. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. Growing up, I was not like a big gamer. You know what a gamer is? A gamer, you know, how many of you guys play video games? Anybody in here? And if you're like, you know, older, don't feel bad raising your hand. It's not a trick question, right? Some people love video games. I was not a gamer growing up. I did not play a lot of video games. Some of that might be because they didn't exist when I was younger. Some of that might be we couldn't afford them. Matter of fact, our idea of playing a game outside of board games was we had this table thing about this big, and it was a football game, and the table was metal, and it had these little magnet football players. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Anybody like under the age of 45 is like, what is he talking about right now? And this was like epic fun for us. Like this football field thing, metal, and had these little magnetic football players on it. And you would line them up, and then you would push this little button, and the thing would vibrate. I think you can still find it on Amazon. And hopefully your players would go in the right direction. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You know, it's like, hopefully they go in the right direction. And you would strategically set these guys up to try to block for your player and try to get your player moving forward. And one of the other players touches it, then he's down. And you had to be super strategic. Well, I graduated from that into the day of when computers were invented. Yes, that happened way back when I was young. Computers were invented. And there was this football game. I don't know what it was called, but it had X's and O's. Like, literally, there were O's and X's. And what you would do is you would go in and you would program what play you wanted them to run. And then if you were the X's would run that play. And then, the other guy would program what defense he wanted to play. And the O's would run there. And hopefully, you outsmarted them. And you'd sit there and have to set this up. Well, when I first learned to play that, I had no idea what I was doing. No one explained it to me. And so, like, he would be over there typing in keys and stuff, and I'm just looking at him like, what's going on? What am I supposed to do? And then, of course, his guys would score, they'd steal the ball and all this stuff. And I had no way of knowing what to do or how to move forward, and I was like, what's going on? Until someone finally showed me that, hey, what you got to do is you've got to actually program these X's and these O's to do what they're supposed to do, and they'll run out the play. Are you with me? I've come to realize something in my walk with Jesus. That in my walk with Jesus, just because I said yes to him, and that day I said yes to him, I still remember when it was, that just because I said yes to him doesn't mean that everything is going to play out perfectly in my life. That just because I said yes to him, that like I said a prayer and I attend church and I hear somebody sharing verses and man, I came to worship and it was great, that there's still some real life out there and there's still some things going on. And here's what I've realized, that if I don't get involved in my faith, nothing seems to progress. That if I don't strategically get involved in my walk with Jesus, that's what the Bible says. It says this, it says, hey, you ought to exercise yourself towards godliness. Now, some of us have no idea what the word exercise means. Like, do what? Like, exercise, like I got this physique, come on, somebody. Because I'm in the gym all the time, right? Like when you see somebody that is like in shape and you're like, wow, like, it, you know, like, maybe sometimes it's natural, but let's be honest, it's because they're in there exercising, right? When you see someone excelling in their faith and growing in Jesus, it's because they're exercising their faith. They're working out their faith. Is somebody with me this morning? You got to exercise yourself unto godliness. You got to work out. Here's what I've realized, that, man, I'm not going to grow and I'm not going to see the things God has for me unless I get involved in what God is doing. You could want a miracle. You could want a breakthrough. You could want change in your life. But listen to me, there's something you've got to do. I mean, Proverbs 16:9 says that man plans his ways, but the Lord directs his steps. How many of you guys are thankful that God's directing our steps as Christ's followers, as Christians, that he would direct our steps? But here's the thing. I meet with people sometimes, and we do, you know, pastoral care and counseling, and I'll just ask them some questions, and they don't feel like they know the direction of God, but I'll ask them some simple questions like, well, yeah, he'll direct, but what are you giving him to direct? Are you making any plans? Are you applying wisdom? Are you applying scripture? Are you living godly? It's getting quiet here, right? Are you doing those things? Are you giving him something to work with? Nothing moves from disorder to order without intelligence and energy applied to it. Nothing moves in the right direction unless there's intelligence and wisdom applied to it. Throughout all of scripture, you're going to see this. There is divine sovereignty, that which God does and only he can do, and human responsibility. There's the part that God plays, and there's the part that we play. And time again, God invites us into what he's doing. Out of all the miracles, okay, there's like 37 of them. Out of all of the miracles referenced that Jesus did in scripture, now we know that he probably did many more, but the ones that are mentioned in scripture, out of all of them, nearly all of them happened because someone came to Jesus and asked him for something. The other ones, what we see is that Jesus, before he does the miracle, he actually invites them in to participate in it. He actually asks something of them. Let's look at a few of them. We won't turn to them, but you can write it down. Mark chapter 2. There's a story of a guy who's paralyzed and he's unable to walk. And the Bible says that some of his friends put him on a mat. They hear that Jesus is in the town and he's preaching. And so they take him to the area, the town that he's being preached, where he's preaching, and take him to the house. The Bible says that the house is so packed they can't get in. And so these guys, what do? They go up on the roof, they tear open the roof, and the Bible says they lower their friend down in front of Jesus. And in Mark chapter 2, it says this. It says that Jesus looked up and saw their faith. And when he saw their faith, he ministered to the man and healed him. What's happening there? People are doing something. Mark chapter 3. Here's a great story about a man who's in church on a Sunday. And there's a bunch of, the Bible calls them Pharisees. They're the ones that live according to this religious law. And Jesus is there teaching and whatnot. But anyway, there's this man with this withered hand. And Jesus wants to make a point to all of the people that he's the healer. And healing can take place whenever he wants. And he calls the man up. And this is what he says to the man. He says, hey, man, stretch out your hand. And as the man takes initiative and stretches out his hand, the Bible says that his hand becomes completely whole. Let's look at another one. Mark chapter 5. In Mark chapter 5, there's a story of a woman that is known as the woman with the issue of blood. She had an issue going on, and the Bible said it had lasted 12 years. And she hears that Jesus is in town, and so she goes out into public, which she's not supposed to do because of the issue of bleeding. But she makes her way out, and the Bible says that she makes her way through the crowd as Jesus is passing by, and she takes the initiative, and she reaches out and touches the hem of the garment of Jesus. And the Bible says in that moment, she was healed. And Jesus stops and recognizes that power had flown out of him and touch somebody. The woman took initiative. She reaches out, she touches Jesus. Matthew chapter 14, the feeding of 5,000. This is an incredible story where Jesus, man, he is there, and thousands of people come to to hear the teaching of Jesus, and he's really long-winded. Come on, somebody. And he preaches so long that the Bible says it goes into dinner time. And so the disciples come to Jesus, and they're like, hey, man, you've been preaching really long. Come on, somebody. Sounds like some of my leaders talking to me sometimes. Pastor, we got pulled pork. Stop. They say, Jesus, hey, look, it's late, and, man, the people are hungry. And you know what Jesus says to them? Jesus says, don't send them away. He says, you give them something to eat. What? And they're like, look, they didn't come prepared. We don't have enough food for 5,000 people. That's what Jesus says. He said, go and see what you do have. And they come up with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. And say, well, here's what we have, but what's this for so many that are here? And Jesus says, give it to me. And they give him the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, which is not enough to feed 5,000 people. But yet Jesus does a miracle because they were willing to give him something. John chapter 5, there's a story about a man laying by the pool of Bethesda, and he's been laying there, and the Bible says that he's been literally crippled for 38 years, laying there. Jesus comes along, sees him, and says, hey, what do you want? Well, it's obvious what he wants. He's laying there amongst all these sick people. He wants to be healed, but Jesus asks him, hey, what do you want to have done for you? Mark chapter 10, there's a story about a guy named blind Bartimaeus. The Bible says that Jesus was walking along, and a throng of people were with him walking, and then here's blind Bartimaeus on the side of the road, and he's yelling, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. The Bible actually says that a lot of the people there tried to get him to stay quiet. Hey, hold on, man, just let him do his thing. You know, let him keep going, like be quiet. The Bible says that blind Bartimaeus calls out all the more. And Jesus comes over, and he asks him, what do you want me to do for you? And blind Bartimaeus stretches out his issue and says that I'd receive my sight. And Jesus touches him. The list goes on and on and on. But I believe that here in John chapter 2, the very first miracle that Jesus does, before we even get to these other ones we just referenced, that Jesus is not just simply displaying his glory and his power, because think about it for a moment. You look at all these other miracles that I just referenced. I mean, blind eyes opening, incredible, right? Like a paralyzed guy able to walk again, wow. But what about this first one? Why this whole idea? Why did he turn water into wine for his first miracle? Yes, it was to display his glory to his disciples, because the Bible says his disciples saw his glory and his power, and they believed him. Up until this point, they hadn't even seen a miracle yet, and now they see it, and so they believe him. But I don't just think it was Jesus displaying his power and his glory. I believe that right here, in the very first miracle Jesus does, he wants us to grab hold of some things, and he wants us to understand this, that miracles are still for today, and he wants to involve you in them. There's divine sovereignty, that which he does, but there's human responsibility. What are we giving to him? Are you with me? Like what are we presenting to him? Like, what are we offering him? If we just hold back, well, yeah, I got some stuff going on in my life, but you know what? I mean, there's some people that got it off worse than I do. So that's like that's a reason for you not to give your brokenness to him, let him do a miracle? Well, I don't know. I mean, I've had people pray for me before, and I mean, it just didn't happen. Maybe it's not for me. But what if it is for you? Right? Like, what are you bringing to him? What are you offering to him? As we were doing worship today, I don't remember which song it was, but it was talking about the power of our praise. And man, when we praise and God is there and he's doing miracles, I mean, what is that all about? I mean, the Bible says that he abides, Psalm 23, I think it is, he abides in the praises of his people. You know what that word abide means? The word abide means to dwell or to remain in, or to marry into. If you study out that word abide in that context, it literally means that when we praise, that God comes and abides, he marries into, he's enthroned in, we've created a place for him to come and rest in that moment. But my question to us today is, man, if miracles are still for today and Jesus is a miracle worker and, man, the worship was phenomenal, we're singing about it all morning, why are you not seeing the miracle in your life? And my thought for you today is maybe are you not giving it to him? Are you not giving it to him? So I just want to walk through John chapter 2. No real points, just some observations, and if we can make some observations together and have some fun today. How many of you guys love the Bible? About three of you. Okay, well, that's cool. I'll drink to that. All right. It's coffee, people. Chill. The first observation I want to make is simply this, because I think it needs to be made, and I'll explain why. But the first one is this, is that Jesus is not promoting drunkenness. Can we just put it out there? Because if you read the text and you're reading it for the very first time with maybe no context, you could read through it and be like, whoa, they drank a ton of wine and Jesus was like, bring more. Like, what is going on there? Like, if you have no context and you're just new to the Bible, you're like, oh, okay. Or maybe you grew up in a home like I did. I love you, Mom, but we're going to talk about my childhood just for a moment. And I have my oldest brother here so he can bear witness with me. So I've saved it for today. But growing up in my house, like if there was anything that was remotely like could cause issues, or it was like the devil itself. All right, like I could not go to a movie theater. That's where you're supposed to gasp, right? Like what? No movie theater. What did you do? I played football on a little vibrating metal bar. You know, like all my friends are like, well, what's that? And I'm like, I don't know. Like we didn't play cards, like cards, like it was just bad. It's bad, because if we played Go Fish, it might lead to poker. You know, everyone knows that poker is of the devil. And one of the big taboos was alcohol. Like none in the house. Like even if the word is mentioned, you're going to hell. I might be embellishing a little bit, Mom. Get over it. Laugh. It's funny. Okay? It just, you know, you couldn't have it. And so what it became to me growing up, it became very taboo. Like if I saw somebody with a beer, it's like, oh my gosh. Sinner. You know, like, it was just very taboo. And then one day I'm reading John chapter 2 and I'm like, whoa, wait a minute, Mom, we got to have a conversation. Because, right? But here's what we got to understand. Jesus is not promoting drunkenness, okay? And here's the thing. When you're reading your Bible and studying your Bible, one of the greatest mistakes you could make is just taking one section of verses and sticking there and saying, well, this is it. No, you got to expound on it. You've got to look into other passages and other chapters and other stories and get the context and know what's going on. We know that Jesus is not promoting drunkenness because the Bible says this in Proverbs 23:19-21. It says, my child, listen and be wise. Keep your heart on the right course. Do not carouse with drunkards. And you can look up the word carouse later. Or feast with gluttons. For they are on their way to poverty, and too much sleep clothes them in rags. Galatians 5:19-21, it says, when you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissension, divisions, envy, and drunkenness. Wild parties and other signs like these. Let me tell you again, as I have before, that anyone living that sort of a life will not inherit the kingdom of God. Ephesians 5:18 says, do not be drunk with wine, because that will ruin your life. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. So what is taking place here? Here's what's taking place. Weddings in those days weren't just like, how many guys have been to a wedding and by the end of it, you're like, oh my gosh, is this thing almost over? Right? Like it's been going for 5 hours, you know? Weddings back then were a full-blown celebration that could last days and even up to a week, okay? And people, because they didn't have Instagram, come on, somebody. They forgot the invite because it came like by person like 7 months ago, you know? And so people would show up, and as they show up, the celebration would just continue. And so what's happening here isn't that, oh man, they drank so much and now Jesus is giving them more. So that's not what's taking place. What's taking place is there is people there celebrating the beauty of marriage, and the festival was so awesome, and they ran out and they needed more. And so Jesus does a miracle and brings more. Now, some of you be like, well, what about the part where it says that you bring out, you know, the best first and then the other stuff last? What's that all about? That's speaking more to the miraculous power of Jesus than anything. That the miracle he did was so profound and so amazing that it was the best wine they had ever tasted. So, no. And I had to answer that one because I'll be honest with you, when I was studying, I was like, wow, there might be somebody in there that could take that wrong. What's the next observation? Next one is this. Jesus is not being disrespectful to his mom. All right? Like, Jesus is not, like, disrespectful. It's not like when he says, woman, what does that have to do with us? But I'll be honest with you, when I was younger, I read that one too. And I thought, huh, Jesus did it? My mom comes in, she's like, hey, Ben, you need to clean your room. I'm like, woman, what does my messy room have to do with you? That didn't go over too well, all right? And I've had a clean room ever since, praise Jesus. Okay? This is not Jesus being disrespectful to his mom. Matter of fact, if you go to the original Greek and you look at the way this actually really translates, it's really a term of endearment. It's ma'am. And it's not in the tone of, ma'am, what is it? It's like there's a conversation taking place there, and he's actually being very disrespectful. But here's the point of it that you need to catch. In this moment, Jesus does something very significant. In this moment, when he's about to display his power and his glory for the very first time and do his very first miracle, he wants to make a distinction. So he doesn't say, mom, come on. He wants to make a distinction, and rather than saying mom, rather than saying mother, he uses a very endearing term, ma'am, because he wants to separate out the fact that I'm not doing this because my mom is asking me to do it. I'm about to set something up, and I'm about to show people here presently in that passage, but all those that are going to read it for future too, that I'm not doing this because my mom asked me. I'm doing this because, you know what, I'm going to display my glory and my power for everybody, and that anyone can draw on the power of Jesus. Which leads me to my next observation in this text, and it has to be observed, is that we can move the hand of God. We can, as Christians, as Christ followers, move the hand of God. What do I mean by that? I mean, I just mentioned it a little bit ago, right? Like he abides in the praises of his people. Psalm 22:3, right? He abides in the praises of his people. When we praise, man, he comes, he's there, he dwells, he remains. Look at John chapter 2, verse 4. What does Jesus say to his mom? He says, my time hasn't come yet. In other words, hey, this is going to happen out of order. This isn't where I planned on doing this. But you know what? Since you asked, I'm going to do it. Think about how powerful that is for a moment. Jesus himself is like, it's not the right time. It's not the right season. I was saving this for later. Like, I, you know. But you know what? Since you asked, I'm going to do it. Think about how powerful that is that right here, and what he does before that, he doesn't call her mom. I'm doing it for you, mom, because you're so great. Thanks for raising me. I love you. Separates it out and says, well, since you asked, ma'am, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. And you and I need to understand that we can move the hand of God. James 1:22 says this. It says, don't just be a hearer of the word only, but be a doer of the word. Like, don't just be someone that's here consuming and hearing and hearing and hearing, but when you hear it, walk it out, live it out, do something with it. And that word doer in James 1:22, it's described this way. It's like a poet writing poetry, like scripting something out. It's the other idea there is like an actor on a stage. So I'm not just going to hear the word, but I'm gonna act it out. I'm gonna walk it out. I'm going to live it out. I'm going to do the word that he tells me to do. We can move the hand of God. James 4:8 says this: draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Here's the awesome thing about that verse, is no matter how big your step is in drawing near to God, God's steps are a lot bigger than yours. And so my step is like, oh, I'm drawing near. And then God's like, sweet, me too. We draw near to God. He draws near to us. We can move the hand of God. James 5:17 says this. It says, there's a man named Elijah. Elijah was a man with a nature just like ours. And he prayed that it would not rain, and for 3.5 years it didn't rain. And then he prayed again, and the rain came. What is that all about? I think it goes back to John chapter 2. Jesus, it's not my time, but since he asked, I'm going to do it. Now, I want you to understand something here. Our relationship with Jesus is not like, it's not like he's a magical wand, okay? When I say we can move the hand of God, I'm not like, hey, you know, Jesus is in my hand and I can do whatever I want, right? Because the Bible even talks about, like, you can ask of him, but when you ask, you know, it's not happening because you're asking wrongly. So we're not talking about, like, Jesus being like this wand that we can wield and be like, hey, Jesus, I need this now. Boom, there it is. It's not what we're talking about. What we're talking about is understanding the power that's in Christ and that we have access to it as sons and daughters of Christ. That we can draw on it when we pray according to his will and his nature. There's a saying that says this, that that he does nothing on earth except by invitation. That he's going to do it, but if you invite him into it. Why is that? Because if you go all the way back to Genesis, what happened? He gave us the power and the dominion over the earth. He said, hey, this is all yours. Be fruitful, multiply, fill it. Now it's up to us to say, hey, we've read the rest of Genesis. We ain't that smart. Could you come? We're inviting you in. God, we need you. We need you. But John chapter 2, it's not my time. My time hasn't come yet. But yet he does it. He does it anyway. To me, honestly, this speaks of being a person of prayer, being in a position of prayer, being in a place of prayer, having connection. Because here's, at the end of the day, I want you to understand this. I am not pursuing miracles. I am not pursuing signs and wonders. I am pursuing the miracle worker. I am pursuing the one that can do signs and wonders. And along the way, as I pursue him, I believe that at any moment he can do whatever he wants to do if I call upon his name. So don't get this wrong. We're not here trying to teach you, hey, you should pursue a miracle. No, don't pursue a miracle. Always pursue the miracle worker. But know as you pursue the miracle worker, that man, miracles are available today. Breakthrough is here today. Hope is here today. Healing is here today. In Jesus' name. And so we continue to pursue him, knowing that along the way, at any moment, man, when we face a crisis or we face something, like last night, getting the phone call, hey, my mom is going, and prayer starts to happen. And yes, the doctors intervene, but the doctors are even dumbfounded by the miraculous that took that. They're describing it as a miracle. And here's the thing, I've seen miracles time and time again in my own life. I've seen them happen in my own body. I've seen them happen for my children. I've seen God work miracles. I remember one crazy miracle that I'll never forget when I first started in ministry. And I was probably only, I don't know, we were probably 6, 7, 8 months in, something like that, as a youth pastor. And man, great things are happening. Our youth ministry had grown from 5 to 20. Come on, somebody. It was like revival. And we were in this little tiny office suite. It was awesome. And I'll never forget, we were having this special night, you know, for the young people. And like 20 showed up. And we were like, yeah. And in walks this kid with a cast on. And I'm talking to him beforehand. I was like, what happened? He goes, oh, man, I broke my arm last week. And I was like, oh, man, that's too bad. He goes, yeah. I don't even remember what I preached on that night. But at the end of the night, I just felt like God wanted to touch some people. And so I was just like, I don't even remember exactly what I said, but I was just like, if you feel like, you know, you want to get healed. And so he kind of raises his hand. And I'm like, sweet, let's pray for him right now. And so I got all these zealous young people to pray for him, whatever. And we get done praying for him. And he goes, it's healed. And I'm like, yeah, it is. I'm like, how do we know? Like, literally, I'm like, okay. And so literally, I'm like, yes. I was like, let's tear the cast off. Until the voice of reason, known as my wife's voice, is bad. I she's kind of sitting over here, and I see her, and her eyes are getting big. She's like, and I'm like, tomorrow at the doctor's office, you know, like, and I'm like, so I talked to him afterwards. I was like, hey, man, so how long have you known Jesus? And he goes, I don't know Jesus. I'm like, what? He goes, dude, I'm a Buddhist. He goes, but I heard you talking about Jesus tonight. And I was like, I want to be healed. And I was like, how do you know it's healed? He goes, because it feels totally different. I'm like, okay. And I so badly wanted to rip the thing off. Like, so I hear from him the next day, because he goes home and he tells his dad, Dad, I got healed tonight. And his dad's like, what are you talking about? He goes, I went to a youth ministry. He's like, what? You know? He's like, you're not taking that thing off. He goes, Dad, it's healed. He goes, fine. We'll take you to the doctor tomorrow and they'll take it off. But if it's not healed, you're gonna have to live with a broken arm. Go to the doctor the next day, has it taken off, and it's totally and completely healed as if it had never been broke. It's awesome, right? Like, we can move the hand of God. Someone asked me the other day, he's like, hey, so how long does your church service go? And I'm like, like 11:15. I just looked, it's 11:20. But it's because my wife was like Jesus earlier and she went way too long. So it's like, so cut me some slack, all right? The next observation, I just got a couple more, we'll wrap it up. The next observation is this, is we must do what he says. We must do whatever he says to do. I mean, we move that she moves the hand of God, like Jesus is like, okay, fine. And so she just steps back and points at her son and looks at the servants, is like, hey, do whatever he tells you to do. Which leads me maybe to one of the greatest principles of Christianity, which is this simple obedience to the word. Like, honestly, like our walk of faith, our walk in Christ, man, you can't do it unless you do what he tells you to do. Like, and you say, well, I don't know what he's saying. I'm like, it's right here. Like, this one has like 8,000 pages, you know? How do I know what he's telling me to do? Read the Bible daily, and you'll know what he's telling you to do. Do what he's telling you to do. See, a lot of us, man, I'm just speaking for where I was in my walk, but a lot of us are just waiting on like this audible voice for our next step. Like, what am I to do? And here's the thing you need to understand. Like, I do believe the Holy Spirit speaks. And I do believe you can hear the voice of the Holy Spirit, 100%. But I believe that first you got to start right here and just live this right here. Read the Bible, walk it out, live it. Be holy as he is holy. I mean, what like that's an amazing standard, I know. I wish he would have just said, be holy, and then left holiness up to my interpretation. But he didn't. He said, be holy as I, the Lord God, am holy. And then he gives us a whole book called the Bible for us to read and to learn and to grow. But if we want to see miracles in our life, because again, we're not seeking miracles, we're seeking him. But if you want to see miracles in your life and you want to experience breakthroughs in your life, start with this one. Start by just doing what he says. Like, read the word and live the word. Because that's how the world is going to know that we're actually even Christians. 1 John 2:3 and 1 John 5:2 says that we know him and others know that we know him if we obey and keep his commands. Simple obedience to the word. And I get it. I get it that sometimes when you're reading the Bible, it doesn't all make sense. I get it. I get it when you feel like the Holy Spirit's speaking to you and telling you to do something, and you're kind of like, and we're going to see here in just a minute what they're asked to do. But here's one thing I discovered a long time ago. When God is speaking to you out of his scripture, when you hear the voice of the Holy Spirit, don't try to figure it out. Just do it. Like, just walk in obedience. Like, just take the next step. Like, because the more you try to figure it out, the more you're just going to be like, this doesn't make sense. But I've come to realize a long time ago that what God is asking to do sometimes doesn't make sense to us. But I guarantee you, if you just walk in obedience to what he's saying, you'll look back after years of obedience in your life and be like, oh. I mean, there's been decisions we've made as a couple, and I'm like, babe, I prayed about it. I think we got to do it. And she's like, okay, I'll trust you. Really what she's saying is I'll trust Jesus, because she believes as a leader of my home that I'm praying and seeking Jesus and leading my home in a godly way that I should be. So really what she's saying is like, hey, you're the head of the house. Trust that you're following Jesus. And man, there's things we did that just didn't seem to make sense. And then, and even I am like a little bit like, okay, she's going with me. I'm not alone. I hope it's right, God. And then we look back and it's like, oh. But there's been also times when God spoke to her and I'm like, but I'm getting nothing. I'm like, I don't really hear anything, so I'm just going to trust. Like, let's do this. And we look back and it's like, man. And then I take the credit for it. I was like, babe, aren't you glad we did what I said? That was, I'm so brilliant. Right? A lot of times it doesn't make sense. Why is that? Well, Isaiah 55:8 tells us his ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. They're higher. He sees from a different perspective. And what looks like doesn't make sense to you at the moment, know this, that your perspective is here and it's limited. But his perspective is up here. And if you just say, okay, God, I don't see it, but I'm going to trust you and I'm going to do it. I'm just going to do it, God. I'm going to trust you and I'm going to do it, because your ways are not, man, they're higher, they're bigger, they're brighter. God, I'm following you. I'm following you. This is where Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 comes in, right? Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Don't lean into your own understanding in all your ways. Acknowledge him and he will direct your path. Do whatever he's telling you to do. Don't try to figure it out. Don't try to interpret it. He speaks very clearly. He speaks the way you understand it. I'm telling you right now. He doesn't speak in New King James. Unless that's the way you like to hear it. Me, he speaks to me in New Living Translation. Plain and simple and clear. Right? Like, you should hear some of my conversations with God. He speaks so clear. He speaks to you the way you get it. And so when he says something like, hey, I brought you to, you know, here to the church. You should go feed the homeless. And you interpret that as, hey, Canvas Church needs to start a homeless ministry. That's not what he said. He's calling you to Africa, and you're like, oh, I need to give some money to a missionary in Africa. You know, it's like, no. No, he speaks pretty plain. Now, all we got to do is step out and do what he says. And so here's the mother of Jesus, and she moved the hand of Jesus, and she just points and says, hey, whatever he says to do, do that. Just do that. And so Jesus begins to talk, and right here in the first miracle he does, what he says honestly makes no sense. The Bible says there's these water pots, there's six of them sitting there, and actually describes what they're used for. They're used for Jewish ceremonial washing of their hands. It was the type of pots they were, and what they used them for was to purify their hands before meals and other things. And they believed that the water had to be in those pots because of the what they came from, and they would wash, and so it describes what they are. There's six of them there. He says, hey, Those pots, grab those, put water in them. Now, if you're there and you're hearing the conversation, you're kind of like, what? They want wine. And they're not drunk, Jesus, because Pastor already told us that you don't promote drunkenness. So they're not going to mistake the water for the wine. Like, what is going on right now? And I believe there's so many times in our life when there's a miracle in the making, that God is doing something and he's working something. And yet you're looking at it like, this doesn't make sense. I don't understand it. Doesn't make sense. But he says, hey, get those pots over there. Fill them with water. What? Why those pots? I mean, yeah, it could simply be that those pots were just there. And so he's like, but it's Jesus. He's about to do the first miracle. I mean, he could have done it any which way he wanted. I mean, he could have just thought, and then there's like bottles of wine there. That would be a pretty cool miracle. But yet he wants to involve them in the miracle. There's divine sovereignty. There's human responsibility. The very first miracle that's ever being done. Jesus is teaching us a principle. I'm about to do a miracle. My time isn't here, but I'm going to go ahead and do it because you tugged on me a little bit. But I'm going to use you as a part of the miracle. I'm going to get you involved. So you see those pots over there? Grab those pots. Fill them with water. And so they go. And they do what he says. And they fill them with water. I mean, there's so much around the pots, but my wife went long, so I'm going to bring it to a close. Love you. The Bible says that they grab the pots. They fill them with water. And then he says this, now I want you to take it to the master of the ceremonies. Do what he's telling you to do. But my next observation is this, is we should keep walking it out. We should keep walking out what he's telling us to do. Like, it didn't just stop with, see those pots, fill them up. Okay, we're done. No, he says, then now what I want you to dip in, and I want you to grab some. I want you to take it to the master. And here's the crazy thing about this to me. If I'm the one, because the Bible says the wine got there, the master of the ceremonies didn't know where it came from, but the servants knew. But as the servant, I also know that I just filled up these pots with water. And all I know is that the last time I saw it was water. And yet somewhere between the filling up the pot with water and getting to the lips of the master of the ceremonies, a miracle had taken place. I don't know where it took place. I don't know if it took place when they were pouring the water into the pots. I don't know if it took place when they were dipping the water out of the pots. I don't know if it took place as they were walking it to the master of the ceremonies. I don't know if the minute it touched the master of the ceremonies' lips, that's when the water turned to wine. All I know is somewhere between doing what Jesus told me to do and the end result, there was a miracle that took place. See, I don't know where the miracle is going to happen. I don't know if it's going to happen on day one, day two, day three, day four, day five, day six, day seven. I don't know if it's going to come the first time I pray for my marriage that seems broken, or if it's going to happen on the third day that my marriage seems broken. All I know is that somewhere between what God told me to do and the end result, my obedience is a miracle in the making. That what I'm doing, walking out what he told me to do, I got to believe that somewhere in here, God, you're here and you're going to bring this to fruition, that you're going to meet the need, that you're going to bring the provision, that you're going to do the miracle. All you're asking of me is to get involved and be obedient to do what you're telling me to do. And somewhere from the time they put the water in the pots to the time it got to the lips of the master of the son, they had to keep walking. And with every step, I don't know about you, but if I'm the guy carrying it, I'm peeking. I'm looking. Is it wine yet? Nope. Is the marriage healed yet? Nope. Has the provision come yet? Nope. Has the healing happened yet? Nope. Then what are we doing? We're walking out in obedience, exactly what he told me to do. And if I keep walking it out in obedience, I believe that God's going to meet me. Maybe the miracle won't look the way you wanted it to look. Maybe the miracle won't happen the way you wanted it to happen. Maybe the miracle you had planned in your mind was subpar to the miracle that he has planned. Because when the master of the ceremonies tasted it, it wasn't just wine. He said it's the best wine he had ever tasted. Somewhere in your simple obedience, as you surrender it to him, as you stretch out that withered hand, as you lower your friend through the roof, as you tug on the garment of Jesus, there's a miracle in the making. God, we thank you so much for your word today. God, we thank you that your word is awesome. God, we thank you that your word, God, encourages, strengthens, corrects, challenges. And I pray that this morning as we wrap up this service here at Canvas Church, that you would challenge every single one of us. First and foremost in our perspective of who you are. God, but also secondly, you would challenge us in this, that we would stop holding on to the brokenness. We would stop holding on to the hurt. We would stop holding on to the sickness, the disease. We would stop holding on, but we would come and say, Jesus, here's what you have to work with. Because God, your word declares that we can cast all our cares on you, for you care for us. Do me a favor, just stand to your feet as we close out this service today. I want you to do me a favor. I just want you to close your eyes for a moment. And I want you to think about this. What area in your life does God need to do a miracle? What area of your life do you need a breakthrough? What area of your life do you need hope? What area of your life do you need healing? And you say, man, I've been to this meeting before. I've been there, I've done that. I've heard the messages. Let me tell you something. God will only work with what you give him. And if it looks like 5 loaves and 2 fish, he'll work with it and he'll feed thousands. If it looks like a withered hand that you've been hiding underneath that coat, you stretch it out, he'll work with it. But you got to give it to him. What pain are you holding on to that's causing bitterness in your life? It's causing resentment in your life. Why don't you just try giving it to him today? Watch him do a miracle. Just walk out in simple obedience. See, John chapter 2 is not just about the display of his glory, it's about the display of a miracle. He could have done anything he wants, but he invites him in to the process. And all we got to do is walk out in obedience. And so with every eye closed, every head bowed, you're here today. And thank you so much for coming. You're here and you'd say, you know what, Pastor, I need a miracle. You're not stretching it out to me, you're stretching it out to him. I need a breakthrough. I need hope. I need healing. With every eye closed, every head bowed, I want to know who I'm praying for today. If that's you, can you just shoot your hand in the air everywhere? Come on, just shoot it up. Come on, just shoot it up. Man, there's no shame. There's no shame. And he's a good God. And he loves you. Why was he willing to do that? Because he loves you. Why was he willing to go ahead out of turn and say, okay, it's not my time, but I'm going to do it? Because he loves. Why was he willing to heal the man that was let down through the roof? Because he loves. He loves. There's no shame. There's only hope and healing and breakthrough for you here today. Hallelujah. There's healing for your body. There's healing for your emotions. There's healing for your marriage. There's healing for other relationships in your life. He's here today. He's a good God. He's a healer. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. So, Lord, I pray right now for every hand that went up. Here's what I want to do. I'm going to ask all the small group leaders or prayer team and pastors, come on up. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pray for you. And then I'm going to dismiss. There's some of you, man, you need to stretch that thing out, whatever it is, and you need some more prayer. We're going to pray for you today. Don't let this moment pass you by. So prayer team, come on up. Pastors, come on up. Lord, I thank you so much for today. God, we thank you for your word. God, we thank you that your word is awesome. God, your word is alive. God, your word is living. It's powerful. It's here today, and it's coming forth to bring hope and to bring healing. So God, I pray you would do that in the hearts and lives of every single person. God, I pray specifically for those that raised their hand today saying, man, I need that. That's me. I need that breakthrough. I need that miracle. I need that healing. I need that touch. God, I pray that today would be the day they could look back and say, I encountered the living God. I encountered the presence of God. I got my miracle. I got my breakthrough. Hallelujah. And I pray you would do that in their life. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Hey, if you raise your hand, we want to pray with you and pray for you today. As we dismiss, come on up. We got lots of people up here to pray with you and pray for you. If you didn't raise your hand, or maybe you didn't and you still want to come forward, we're here to pray for you. But as you're making your way out, man, go to the gym, which is just honestly directly right across over that way. We got free food. Hang out, meet somebody, love on somebody. But if you raise your hand, come on up. We're believing right now, hope and healing. Come on, right now, come on up. We're going to pray for you. God bless. Have an amazing week.